Hatcher, Bellevue Christian Center, 1400 Hallville Drive. Please stand for the pledge and remain standing for the invocation. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you for this opportunity to allow your presence to be welcomed in this room. Father, your word says that to give our cares to you because you care for us. And any cares, worries, stresses that these council folks have to decide on, that you would help bring a level of comfort and decision-making and unity, and to know that you're with them and that you want to encourage them through this process. Father, thank you for the privilege of each man and woman up here making decisions for our city. Father, we thank you that I'm reminded of our city called Beautiful View, and it truly is. Father God, I pray your blessings upon this meeting tonight, and we just thank you for the opportunity for you to do something incredible this evening. In Christ's name, amen.
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 Thank you. Item number two, call to order and roll call. Sabrina.
Mr. Carmichael.
Here.
Mr. Hansen.
Here.
Mr. Cook.
Here.
Mr. Preister.
Here.
Mr. Modry.
Here.
Mrs. Blood.
Present.
Mayor Sanders is out of town at a MAPA conference representing the city. That's why she's not here tonight. Item number 2A, Open Meetings Act, posted in the entry to the council chambers. Item number 3, approval of minutes and advisory committee reports. 3A, approval of agenda. Councilmember Blood.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Blood, second by Councilmember Preister. Any discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
Item number 3B, approval of consent agenda. Councilmember Preister.
Thank you. I move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Preister, second by Councilmember Blood. Any discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
Thank you. Item number 3C and 3D were approved under consent agenda. Item number 4, approval of claims, approved under consent agenda. Item number 5, special presentations. 5A, presentation on the pay-as-you-throw pilot program. Epiphany Ramos.
Wastewater manager.
Yep.
Thank you, Council, and special thanks to my director and administrator for helping to support this program. We just hope to give you a broad overview of everything we are trying to accomplish here. And then we've also provided in the agenda packet a lot of details about the proposal and a few other things. And so we'll just open up for some questions, of course, just so we can make sure that we hit on the points that the Council really wants some answers to. I also have some representatives from Papillion Sanitation here today. This is Kim and John. They work with us almost on a daily basis on our contract and looking at different programs that the City of Bellevue can address. So as you know, the program that we're trying to pilot is called Pay As You Throw. It is a national type solid waste management model that we are looking to beta here in an area in Bellevue. One of the biggest challenges, I guess, that if you want to call it that, that we've been trying to address over the last year is, you know, we know that the landfill will be closing. We don't maybe have an imminent date, but we do know that that will happen. With the city being under contract for our solid waste management, it's really on our part as terms of the city to be proactive and looking forward at what are those costs and what are the impact to our residents. And as you know, that the landfill and the manual labor rates really just continue to rise and rise. So, you know, yes, it's very simple to say, sure, we'll just keep raising your rates, residents, and we won't change anything in terms of how we manage the program, but I tend to take a different step in terms of management and say, look, we always have to look at how we can do this efficiently. And in a few years with the landfill potentially closing, our waste will be trucked out of town, and that's an additional, I believe, 120 miles round trip per truck. So I know you guys, I don't need to tell you, just cost savings in terms of, you know, fuel, labor, transportation, that type of thing, but also those carbon footprint, really, that Bellevue will have to be aware of. Oops, wrong way. One thing that we wanted to take a look at is, you know, not only just the what pay-as-you-throw does in terms of recycling, but also just an increased reduction. So as we start to become more aware of our waste, you know, there's a few pictures there that I'm sure are from Bellevue. Our increased waste removal costs, they continue to go up as we discussed, but more importantly, we have to look at ways to continue to reduce, reuse, and recycle. So just a fundamental change in how we evaluate our waste. Because as everything goes, the prices will go up, and if we don't change our processes, we'll continue to see those impacts in a negative fashion. So more about the details on the program. The pay-as-you-throw is kind of a base level, so we'll have a base level there for all of the residents, and it will be carts supplied to residents. That includes their yard waste, their recycling, and their solid waste. Every cart will be labeled, and of course, the automated trucks will be able to be used on these carts, which is a big savings in terms of the carbon footprint. And extra carts and bags, of course, as residents want them, will incur additional fees. It's called pay as you throw because essentially, if you want to have 10 carts, if that is your prerogative to have 10 carts, you can generate as much waste as you want. But often we see a large discrepancy between what maybe our neighbor throws away, the guy across the street, whatever, between what we throw away. If we have a household of five, maybe they are an elder person living alone. You know, there's a lot of differences in terms of what we throw, and I do get a lot of feedback from residents saying, how come it's one base rate? So the fairness of the program has always been very well received in terms of if I don't change my waste management practices in terms of recycling and reduction, I'll be charged according to what I'm actually doing. So the less trash that you throw out, the less the resident pays. It's a very equitable system. It's very common sense in terms of developing behaviors, good behaviors that hit people's pocketbooks the most. Generally, the results are kind of anywhere between a 17 to a 23% reduction in landfill waste. You know, and I think we'll talk a little bit more, too, if we have directed questions about not only just that landfill waste, but also waste, again, in processes and efficiencies because we're carrying less tonnage. So the hauling itself, of course, is a savings. So overarching, some of the summary of what we are got there in that proposal that's in your packet is starting November 1st, we run a beta program for an entire year. And some of the reasoning for that is so that we capture an entire solid waste year, meaning your yard waste. And we want to pilot the neighborhood. That's Castle Ridge. We felt like this neighborhood was a very good choice in terms of size. We wanted to make sure that we didn't grab too few or too many homes so that we could gauge the impact, not only, you know, resident receptiveness of this, but also get a really good idea of the scope of work and the cost savings and efficiencies that we can bring back to council and show them what a larger scale program like this would be for the city. But also Castle Ridge is a little bit of a newer development and has been used to having a subscription or a cart service before. So that's a big thing. You know, the automated trucks have been through those areas. Those were some of the key things that played into that. Residents at this time will have 30 days to opt in, but, you know, as we may be up for discussion, if residents do not decide to opt in, we'll have a couple marketing objectives that we're going to try and meet throughout those 30 days. But if we don't get enough opt-in, so if we do not get those numbers, we'll probably extend that another 30 days and be a little bit more aggressive with the marketing. The feedback thus far is that we feel like we're not going to have any problems meeting any kind of opt-in marks. Each resident out of the gate will receive a trash can, a recycling can, and a yard waste can. And if they want more than that, then it'll be an opt-in. You know, they'll be able to pay $5 for an additional cart, and the automated trucks will be used in those areas for the collection. And the tonnages, I really like this part of the program. Everything is recorded in a software program, so everything that we do is really going to be metered and tracked at to the nth degree, so we make sure that we know exactly what's happening with the beta program. You know, that is the premise of this, is, you know, not only just to get resident feedback, but to gather enough information so that we can potentially look at a citywide contract and know that when we go into the scope of that contract, we have enough data. So just to wrap it up, and then I can open up for questions. We hope that this program will help to understand and refine, again, that citywide program. That's really the primary goal of this, and also, of course, to get the residential feedback. But the intention is that we develop enough data so that we can really walk in eyes open in terms of a citywide program. And we're really confident in the partnership that we have today with Papillion Sanitation to kick off a beta program. And, you know, if something changes in terms of the city's hauler, it's very important for us to have this where we have a good relationship with our contractor and can be very transparent during this type of a program. The city of Bellevue wants to be a leader in terms of the Midwest as a pay-as-you-throw program. You know, as you know, there are programs like this already in some Midwest cities, but it's definitely a lot more prominent on the West Coast and the East Coast. I'm sure you already have done your research and know, you know, the numbers that some of these areas are documenting. But, you know, just to be very fair, that it is happening here in the Midwest, it's just not happening as global scale. As you know, some things happen kind of on outward on the coastal and kind of come in. This isn't one of those things that's always going to trend out there. We all generate waste. We all have the problem with what do we do with it, and that's why it will come to the Midwest and in a fast and furious fashion. The larger cities that pick it up, I think, again, this is an opportunity for Bellevue to be a big leader in it. Did you guys have anything?
I think you covered it well.
Okay. At that point, I just wanted to open it up for questions, which I hope you guys have some.
Councilmember Blood.
I just needed some clarification, first of all. Are we talking about partial unit pricing or variable unit pricing?
Partial unit in terms of, I'm sorry, please elaborate.
When it comes to this program, there's usually three types of
right.
ways that you charge. The full unit pricing, the partial unit pricing, and the variable rate pricing.
For the pilot program, I'll hope to clarify then. For the pilot program, it's three carts. Those residents will still be charged $13.42 a month. Nothing will change in terms of that.
Okay.
If they want an additional cart, let's say there are 396 carts, they say, oh man, we need four more. Okay, great. Then you get four more containers, but it's $5 per container. At this point, we're not offering anything less than that. Some programs will offer, let's say, a stepped, you know, a variable, a 32, a 64, right. a 96. We have done a lot of research in terms of the amount of waste that per household, you know, that's generated here, and we feel like this is out of the gate going to be the easiest receptive. I'm certain that I will have people call me and say, the 96 is so big, I'd rather have a 64 or a 32. I do think that part of having this in a beta program is so that we can evaluate what percentage of our residents potentially would be looking at those types of options, like me and you talked a survey or even door-to-door kind of asking questions about that. But based on the current waste that Bellevue generates per household, and again, the big fluctuations, we do feel like the three carts is going to be well received. So we'll definitely be gauging that, and it'll be kind of a metric too that we'll be able to share.
Well,
that answer the question?
I agree, yeah. The data is going to be invaluable. I see that it gives us not just the environmental benefits, but socially, the more income a household usually makes, and it's just generally.
Yep.
I'm not saying that this is true of all households, but statistically, I saw that the more income that a house makes, usually the more garbage they create. And so this is actually going to be evening the playing field
right.
for people that if you are lower income, you could ultimately pay less for your trash.
Right.
It's like
that's the point. Yep.
Utilities. If you use more utilities, you pay more than your neighbor.
Yeah.
If you use the garbage service less, you pay less. And my statistics are a little better than yours as far as the upper end.
Yeah.
9 to 38% decline in waste is what I saw across the United States, and then 60 to 40% increase in recycling.
We're trying to be conservative, so maybe we'll look like superstars.
I just thought I'd throw that out there. I don't work for the city except as a
conservative kind of look at it is probably the best way to go. And that way, once we, again, gather the data, this is the point of doing a beta program, a pilot program. It is very new. You know, our neighbors in Omaha aren't doing it. Papillion isn't doing it. You know, these other places aren't doing it. It's an opportunity for Bellevue to really shine. And if we're going to do it, I feel like we got to have the data to make a big change like this.
And you should be praised for putting together this pilot program, because it's exactly what you just said. It's exceptional for Bellevue. The only negative question that I have for you that I found happened in a few communities is that sometimes when you charge for waste, it can result in illegal dumping. Is that something that's kind of on your radar yet?
I think we have had those discussions. I think it's about monitoring at this point. Bellevue on a global scale, and this, you know, comes from discussions with Papillion Sanitation, and none of the questions that you're asking aren't things that I haven't already discussed with them too, but they feel like we're really low, comparatively speaking, to some other areas. They call us our garbage clean. You know, they do feel like we're a little bit better stewards of our waste than some other areas. So I think like anything, like when we put the containers down at Hayworth, you know, it's about managing and taking a look. Is contamination an issue? It's time to do something different. If we find that illegal dumping is an issue, you know, we do have information in there that'll go out to residents about bulk charges, which are the same charges that they charge today. But I think it's just something, what do I do with this? If I'm new, I've never got this information. We'll just keep feeding them the information and monitoring it. That's really the best that we can do once we find it to be a problem, or if there is any kind of blip on the radar, it's time to address the program.
So proactive education.
I think so. I think that's the best way. You know, any time, I know we've talked about videotaping, signage, you know, placement of dumpsters. Do we use some of the savings to include, you know, different dumping? Do we do anything different with cleanup days? Those types of things are always in the revolving discussion about the solid waste management for the city.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilmember Preister.
Thank you. Ms. Ramos, what's the current recycling rate in Bellevue?
We're between 38% and 39%, right?
Actually, the last study
participation
did,
rate
participation was 36%.
36% on participation, and recycling rate is under 9%, right?
Actually, 7%
okay.
Was the last.
So that's where we're at.
So we have about a third of the households each week that actually put out recycling. So we have two thirds of the households not putting anything out. Now, I would be one of those because I only put recycling out every other week because I don't generate a lot. So it may be higher. We may have 50 or 60% of the people, but it's still low. And we only have a diversion of 7%
right.
of all of those pieces that become trash. Interesting. I was part of a study that went through a grocery store and we checked all of the packaging along the aisle. 91% of all of the packages on the shelves in the grocery store are recyclable. It's just a matter of putting them in a different container rather than throwing everything absentmindedly into the waste and being good stewards, being exercising personal responsibility. So I just want to commend you because we looked at this prior to not just this last extension of the contract, but the original contract. And at that time, the then Public Works Director said, I think we need to look at it more seriously the next time, but we're not quite ready. So I appreciate that you're in the new role, taking a leadership and looking at other options and doing a trial run. I think that's perfect. We get the feedback, we perfect it now on a small scale, and with Papillion Sanitation on board, I think it's a great partnership. And I think we're doing good things, but we're doing the American way. We're seeing this as a commodity, as something we can make money off of. It can be diverted from the landfill. And a second question, do you know why the landfill, it was scheduled to be closed almost 2 years ago. Why have we been able to keep it open? And John, I don't know if you...
John or Kim might be a better...
Right.
Essentially, Councilman, the answer is they're at a point in that landfill where they're on top. They've just about reached their maximum vertical height, which is very tough to fill. So it was just a best guess when it was supposed to originally close, and they ended up having quite a bit of depression in that waste, which gives them more height to fill to over the year. So it's a moving target in the landfill business, but essentially that's it. The landfill continues to sink, and it's a very difficult area to fill across the top.
Okay,
that has extended its life.
Right, as long as it doesn't reach that maximum height, they can keep putting it.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
But eventually,
they're gonna reach that height.
And at that time, where will our garbage go?
Well, that will effectively leave three outlets in the Omaha metro area. You'll have the Douglas County landfill, which I consider Bennington. You'll have the River City transfer station, which will transfer waste out of town. And then there'll be a Sarpy County transfer station at the current landfill that'll transfer waste out of town.
And that waste from the transfer station will go to?
Will go to David City, Butler County landfill.
And that's where the 60 miles there, 60 miles back.
Yes, sir.
120 miles round trip for all those trucks.
That's correct.
Into the additional fuel cost and expense. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Good creative program. I've seen it work well in Phoenix. Every year I'm out there, and it's very slick. The people really like it, and it's very effective. A lot safer, too, with the single driver truck and the arm collecting. You don't have people running in traffic and the danger to those workers. So all the way around, I think it's a great program. Thank you.
Thank you. Epiphany, I got a couple questions.
Sure.
Would you explain, it is on our agenda, but would you explain how this pilot program is being paid for? Because you're doing it under a unique way.
Yes, it is a unique way. Thank you for bringing it up. Actually, we had a contract, of course, as you know, with Papillion Sanitation. And within the terms and conditions of those contracts, we have a fuel rate. And even to drill down a little bit deeper, there are conditions that say that Papillion Sanitation has to charge us or basically credit us whatever the, and John, you can speak a little bit to what it's called. It's a diesel, what is it called?
Yes, rate that we charge is based on the Omaha area diesel price. So as it has declined, it results in savings to the city.
Okay.
Yep. So basically, we kind of have an interesting situation because we collect those monies from our residents to use for solid waste, period. They're not for anything else that happens. Those are communicated to our residents as being used for solid waste management. So since we have those savings, it's really kind of up to us in administration, council, et cetera, to find good uses for those dollars and cents. We could roll over those savings, try to make some adjustments with maybe our fees, but you know they would only be temporary. So it's a very unique, like you said, very unique kind of piece of pie that we would be tapping into to try and make this pilot program successful.
And then just a couple comments, and if you want to respond to them, you can. And it's just more of a concern. I think it's a great thing to do. I'm glad we're doing it. Under bulky items, it talks about an extra fee to pick up things. And I don't know if we do that today?
Yes. There's a little bit of a grace thing that happens right now with Papillion Sanitation and residents. It's a very non-cost-effective grace thing that happens on the terms of the contractor. The contractor, who has a very good relationship with Bellevue, essentially picks up quite a bit. And they're really not... they're really not contractually bound to do that. The rates that are set out there in terms of the bulky items are what they charge today.
Okay.
You know, there's not any like special Bellevue rate that we came up with. It just is, what do you charge for those additional pickup fees? Let's make sure that we let residents know that that's what they'll need. They can still dump whatever, pretty much whatever they want outside of the cleanup days, but that they'll be charged at those bulk rate fees.
And then it mentions the cost of the carts, and I know you said this $25,000 will pay for that.
Mm-hmm.
But if we institute it, if we put it into play, where does that cost come from? The resident, or are they going to use a completely different trash container?
Or good point.
You're talking about a new trash can that, if it's a one-arm pickup, most people don't have it.
Yes, good point. We're hoping that some of these residents, one of the reasons why we picked Castle Ridge was because they were in a subscription-based area, and so some of them may have some of the carts. They may just need an additional two carts or so. Some of them may not have anything, which is fine. But what we will do, roughly $25,000 is the almost what would you call not to exceed number. So if we only get 200 residents to opt in, and of those 200 residents, 100 of them have one 96-gallon cart that's available with the, you know, that the automated trucks can use, that's great. We'll just tell them that now you'll get two other carts if you'd like them. So it's not that that's the hard find cost. It is that that's per container. So whatever we end up purchasing, of course, that would be a savings delta.
But with it being a pilot program, if I'm a family with 6-8 kids, are you going to give me 3 or 4 trash carts? Or do I have to pay for number two and number three?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, very good question. I had the same question to Papillion Sanitation, and the answer was that we would just have the $5 monthly charge, correct?
That's correct.
Yes.
For any additional
So they won't get charged the additional carts.
The resident will not?
No.
Okay. And part of my concern is that if we
implement absolutely, because they're like $200 a piece or something, yeah.
Yeah. That if we would put that cost on the citizens, we probably would hear from them.
I had the same thought.
and one last thing. I lived in a SID, and Papillion Sanitation picked up the garbage. We went from probably 3 different carriers, so we had like 9 trucks on your trash day, you know, picking up the yard waste and household and everything, which was crazy. We finally did a contract with Papillion, and they did use the arm. They provided the trash carts, all of them, and I think we were only paying like $1 more a month than the residents in the city.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm hoping that maybe if there's savings down the road that the cost of carts and everything can maybe somehow be built in instead of asking a resident to, hey, you got a $200-$300 cost here for carts.
Well, I think when we get to the equitable system, here's what we do have. They are still going to be charged that base $13.42 just like they are today. Mm-hmm. But additional carts will be additional $5 a month. So your subscription maybe was $1 less or $1 more. You probably did have 2 to 3 carts in your subscription. So what we're saying is 4 more carts, you're going to pay more than your neighbor who only has 2. They're still going to pay that $13.42, but you're going to have to pay the additional $5 per cart, which is where we're trying to get, again, to create some change in terms of attitudes and, you know, responsibility for what you do with your waste. So if you want to create waste, you can create it all day, but it will end up costing you a little bit more than the typical. But again, that's why we went to Carol's point about the 32, the 64, and the 96. The typical subscription areas are getting the 96ers, and that seems to be working for them, and that's why we kind of went with that. I do definitely see areas where, you know, a smaller cart might be valuable, but again, collecting the data through the program, getting the resident feedback on receptability to those different types of levels or tiers of offering, is going to be valuable to us to determine how we roll it into a large contract.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Muldry?
Thank you. Tiffany, what is the typical volume or weight of yard waste within the city now? Do you know that? And is that conducive to the 96-gallon container?
Yes, sir. Right now, over a year's period of time, it averages out to 7 pounds per resident per week, to give you an idea. Now, you bring up a good point. Leaf season is I believe, going to be one of our challenges. And I think this program will encourage mulching, if you will, and other alternatives to, you know, 15 to 20 bags of leaves. But that's one thing that we'll really have to keep an eye on, and one of our initial concerns would be leaves.
Right. Also, if we do not adopt the program after the pilot for whatever reason, is there an opportunity to recoup some of our cost for those carts?
Yes. Yeah, we'd be willing to work something out to buy those carts back from you based on the condition of them. Sure.
Thank you.
You bet.
Any other questions? Can Kim and John sign in? Probably should sign in for us. Thank you, Epiphany.
Thank you.
For the presentation. Item number 5A. One, approval of the pay-as-you-throw pilot program in the amount of $25,440 to be funded by the solid waste savings recognized from fuel savings in the solid waste contract for this fiscal year. Councilmember Blatt?
Motion to approve the amount of $25,440 funded by the solid waste savings recognized from fuel savings in the solid waste contract for this fiscal year.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Blatt, second by Councilmember Carmichael. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
Thank you. Item number 6, liquor licenses. 6A, St. Mary's Church, special designated liquor license application to sell beer and wine during a trivia night fundraiser on October 2nd, 2015 from 4 p.m. to 11 p.m. at St. Mary's Elementary School, 903 West Mission Avenue. Is there a representative here? Will you please state your name?
Brian Miller.
Anybody have any questions or comments for Mr. Miller? I'll open this up for public input. Would anybody like to speak? Seeing no one coming forward, I'll close it. Mr. Miller, do you have anything you'd like to say? Or?
I don't think so, sir.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Blood.
Yes, I would like to make a motion to recommend approval to the Nebraska Liquor Commission for the special designated liquor license application from St. Mary's Catholic Church to sell beer and wine during a trivia night fundraiser on October 2nd, 2015 from 4 p.m. to 11 p.m. at St. Mary's Elementary School, 903 West Mission Avenue.
Second.
Motion made by Councilmember Blood, second by Councilmember Priester. Any discussion? Councilmember Modri?
Thank you. Yes, I'll be abstaining from votes on 6A and 6B for religious and personal reasons.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Seeing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes, one abstention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Item number 6B, Joseph O'Shea, manager application of the Class C liquor license held by Eagles Fraternity Order 3912 at 207-211 West Mission Avenue. Hello, sir. Would you please state your name?
Joseph O'Shea.
Thank you. Anybody have any comments or questions? I'll open up for public hearing. Would anybody like to speak on this application? Seeing no one come forward, I'll close public hearing. Councilmember Blood.
Yes, I would like to make a recommendation to make a motion for a recommendation to the Nebraska Liquor Commission for Joseph O'Shea and his manager application for the Class C liquor license currently held by the Eagles Fraternal Order number 3912 at 207-211 West Mission Avenue.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Blatt, second by Councilmember Carmichael. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I'll vote yes.
All voted yes, one abstention.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Item number 7, ordinance for adoption, none. Item 8, ordinance for public hearing, second reading, none. Item number 9, ordinances for introduction, first reading, 9A, ordinance number 3818, compensation ordinance. Sabrina?
Ordinance number 3818, an ordinance of the city of Bellevue, Nebraska, classifying the employees of the city, fixing the ranges of compensation of such employees, providing a pay range schedule, providing for publication in pamphlet form, repealing ordinance number 3778, and providing for an effective date.
Thank you. The second reading for public input will be on at our next meeting on August 24th. Item number 9B, ordinance number 3819. Sabrina?
Ordinance number 3819, an ordinance to adopt the budget statement to be termed the biennial appropriations bill, to appropriate sums for necessary expenses and liabilities to provide for an effective date.
Thank you. The second reading for that will be on August 24th, and that will take public input. Mr. Erlowitz?
Thank you, Council Member Cook, President Cook. It will be, this is just up for first reading. However, there are some key points that I do want to cover at this point, since it's now to the council for consideration. Back on July 15th, the administration held a forum. It was to present a preliminary 2015-17 biennial budget proposal. Subsequent to that forum, we received some public input. And from there, then we finalize the administrative proposal, which was provided to the City Council on July 24th. There are some key points that I'd like to cover that this budget proposal reflects. The proposal does maintain existing staffing and service levels without a proposed increase in our property tax levy. That would pertain to the budgets and departments that are funded through our general fund, in which property taxes go to fund those departmental operations. In terms of staffing, the present number of positions that are authorized for departments, it would maintain. It's not the current number of bodies, because we have people leave and we have hiring all the time, but it is the positions within those departments. It also provides for market-based compensation increases. Although there are no incremental increases in the number of employees, as I'd indicated in terms of slots, the budget does provide for wage increases, promotions, and movement of employees through department restructuring for efficiency and effective operations. We have a number of departments that have asked for the ability to upgrade positions, for promotions, for restructuring, and in several departments to enhance efficiency and effectiveness. Departmental expenditures are in line with projected inflation over the next 2 years. This budget also creates a whole new fund, the Economic Development Fund. In November 2014, the citizens of Bellevue approved an LB 840 plan. That is a local option municipal economic development program. It's targeted to being able to put infrastructure in place along the Highway 34 corridor. That particular fund is proposed to be funded through community betterment funds. Those are the Keno dollars which come into the city. While the citizens approved the plan in November, there was not a separate funding mechanism approved for additional funds. So it was approved with the intent that we take resources that we currently have to use and fund that program. And the administration feels that because the community betterment is for community economic development, as well as quality of life, that it would be appropriate to fund it out of that fund as opposed to sales tax or property tax, which we already know we have committed to our other operational needs. It also provides for bringing the new convention center to fruition. I think most of you are aware, if you've been out on near the theater, Margus Theaters or Culver's, out on Twin Creek, the city, in conjunction with Twin Creek Development and Kenseth Company, a hospitality company, we have a new convention center that's being built. Along with that, there's also a new courtyard, Marriott Courtyard Hotel, that's being constructed along with that. We're hopeful that if the weather cooperates, that a year from now, well, less than a year from now, hopefully next spring, both will be able to completion of the hotel and the convention center for an opening in spring of 2016. It also includes in the capital improvement part of the budget, because the budget includes both operational funding for city operations, and it also includes a capital projects budget. The capital projects budget does include an aquatic center that would be subject to the council bringing it forward for a public vote, as well as then voter approval. It was put in to address the aquatics needs. The council obviously will have the ability to weigh in on that, but we felt it was important to at least have that as a place marker in this budget, because that issue does need to be addressed. The administration's proposed total biennial budget proposes a revenue projection of $147,729,058 That's an increase of 11% from the prior two-year biennial budget, which was the 2013-2015 budget. It proposes expenditures of $148,318,646, which is an increase of 15% over the prior biennial budget. The biennial operating deficit, I've indicated what the projected revenues are and projected expenditures are. That would, though, still leave a projected operating deficit of $589,588, which would be funded from existing cash reserves already committed to Highway 370, police retirements, and park improvements. Another element, which is always important every year when we initially develop our budget, the county assessor provides us with a preliminary estimate of what the city's property valuation is, which determines the amount of property tax revenue we collect. The valuations since 2009 have not increased significantly. In 2009, property valuation totaled $2.69 billion. In projected, estimated this for 2015, it's $2.72 billion. So it's not a significant increase over that period of time, which is one of the reasons why budgeting for the city of Bellevue has been a challenge. In terms of the process for the budget moving forward, tonight was the first reading for the appropriations ordinance. There will be, the city council will also then take up the budget proposal at its August 24th meeting, which then there will be a public hearing, as Councilmember Cook indicated. We will have then the first meeting in September. Will it be at the time when the council will actually formally adopt the budget, which then has to be submitted to the state auditor by no later than September 20th of this year. And that's all I had.
Thank you. Any other comments? Councilmember Priester.
Thank you, Councilmember Cook. I want to thank Mr. Berlewitz for going over that again. When we're talking about this large an amount of money, it's important to have clarity and to have the public well aware of what we're doing. I think each year in the budget process, we have gotten more open, more responsive, had more information out earlier, including the already conducted public hearings. This is a good process. It's a good thing. I think the mayor and the administration have put together a very essentially bare bones budget. It may be too bare, and we may be into bone, and I think the public needs to weigh in on that. Do we have firefighters, or do we stay at status quo? We have some things that are going to be very tough and difficult decisions to make as we go forward. Currently, with this budget, we add no staff, we add no new positions, and that includes the fire department, it includes the police department, it includes the public works department, and we'll get into much more of that in detail. But if the public expects the level of service, and as inflation and costs for everything continue to go up, you can't do it on the same amount of money. So I have already gotten some calls with people talking about a restaurant tax being the fairest of tax increases, and I'm certainly listening to that. So I think my query to the public is, what do you want? And next meeting will be your opportunity to come and tell us. Do you want a $4 million aquatic center that's only open eight, at most 9 weeks of the year for teenagers who can drive to the larger, bigger ones? Or would you rather have that money in local neighborhood swimming pools or in our splash pads? You've been giving us input, but the rubber meets the road at the public hearing next time. So are you up for property tax increase? Are you willing to go the status quo without having firefighters and possibly having reduced times if you're in need for one? Those are the tough questions that the council and the mayor and the administration are facing. They're not easy, and we welcome anyone who has good ideas in how we can approach this. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Berlowitz.
Yeah, and Councilmember Pricer makes obviously a very important point. I didn't cover it tonight, but really what he's really alluding to is the fact that the city 2 years ago moved to initially started to a priority-based budgeting process, which is what he's indicated. What do you want? And essential is, what are the services that our citizens want, and what are you willing to pay for? And that's the critical element. And so input is critical. We did an online budget survey. We also did the public forum, which was intended to receive input. And clearly there are some significant priorities, but it is important for you, the public, as we move forward, to provide that input to the council, as well as the administration has tried to listen to it. And so that is very important.
Thank you. Thank you. Item number 10, public hearings on matters other than ordinances. 10A, public hearing on the request for a conditional use permit to erect a 100-foot monopole communication tower. Applicant SBA Towers the Fifth, LLC, location 501 West 29th Avenue, Gilbert Pool Park. Do we have a representative here from S? Would you just please state your name and sign in?
Good evening. My name is Joe Coyle, and I'm here on behalf of SBA.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm going to open this up for public hearing. If anybody would like to speak about item number 10A, 1 or 2, we'll just put it together, and then after the public hearing and council discussion, we'll call for votes. Come forward. Please state your name and sign in, please.
Hi, good evening. I'm Jason Neugebauer.
Okay. And we'll give speakers 5 minutes.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Jason Neubauer. I live at 414 West 30th Avenue. In the invocation, he said that it's a beautiful view, and Gilbert Park and Gilbert Pool is one of the main reasons that I came to Bellevue, because it's beautiful there. And a 100-foot tower is 10 stories tall. That's maybe taller than the tallest structure in your entire town. I don't know, but it's really tall. It's in a location that is central to the park, right in front of the parking lot and next to the pool. I see kids out there playing frisbee and throwing the football around all the time. It's gonna have a large fenced area, which is really gonna make it look pretty tacky, with like a large compound at the edge of the park, kinda in the highest point on the entire park area. It's gonna be big, a big parking lot inside of a big enclosure with a 100-foot tall tower, tallest tower probably in the town. And I'm asking, why didn't they look for private land first to build this instead of using our beautiful park? I mean, there's gotta be land somewhere that you could put a 100-foot tower. And I think you could probably get all of Bellevue with a 100-foot tower from any point in the town. It's gonna devalue the neighborhood, which is unfortunate. And I think they chose this location because it's gonna be very easy for them to build. And the way they zoned it, there's very few people that actually got handed the note saying, hey, you're gonna be affected by this. They were very careful to pick very few people, but you notice this swimming pool where all the kids come to swim is smack dab in the middle of that area that's gonna be affected by this. So, you know, think about your beautiful view here and what this is gonna do for you. That's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Blood?
Could we have the Assistant City Administrator come forward and answer those questions as to why this area was selected?
Hello, everyone. The question again?
The question I hear from the citizen is, why was this particular area selected over, say, other areas of private land or other areas around Bellevue?
Typically, the cities and the tower companies have a better chance of getting this within the community where it needs. Also, there was an engineering study. I believe Joe may be able to explain how that was done first. Engineers take and find out where the best optimal location is, and if there's and this was one of the areas from the engineering study, so they approached the city.
So if I hear you correctly, you're saying that they looked at our community and they looked for the best place for the base station where they will plant the antenna. Basically, they're looking for a cell within a cell, because as cell phone usage becomes more prominent, the bigger cells become smaller cells because there's so many more people using cell phones. And so they're looking for the location that's going to serve the cell phone users the best.
Actually, I believe this is a data capacity site, not necessarily a cellular service site.
So what's the difference?
The frequency of the waves, if I'm not mistaken, is that correct? Joe?
So are you still talking about RF waves?
Yes, this is a capacity site. Verizon would be the first tenant on the tower, so that's the company that comes up with the search area. And the search area for capacity site is very small and specific. The search area basically centered around the Betts Elementary School or the park. Those are the only spots in the search area that would have enough room for a footprint for the tower. Capacity versus coverage is what we're talking about. There's an existing site, Verizon's network grid, at the Air Force Base. And so this site would is near enough to that. It serves to offload that site as that site becomes overworked, essentially.
And so is it true that, as opposed to some of our older towers, that the frequencies are more linear than the way they were in the past, that it's, I don't know if safer is the right word, because, you know, obviously radio frequency, I mean, we're all smart enough to know that they do cause health issues, but that the newer ones are much less harmful than, say, the ones that they first put up in Bellevue?
Yeah, you know, you can go out on the internet and find just about anything.
On yes
either
no?
side of the coin. Well, I'm not an RF engineer, but I would say that, you know, the FCC is who governs that.
Right.
And, you know, all towers have to abide by their rules and those output levels that they set.
Well, and I did do a lot of research on this, especially the cancer aspect, because we're talking about people ultimately. And what I found was you get more RF rays from putting the cell phone to your ear than you do by living by a tower.
Correct. You know, there are articles out there that say, and you'll see there's a new tower over here at Central Elementary. They say, hey, if you see a proposal at your kid's school to put up a tower, go ahead and vote for it, because that device that's up against your head will have to work harder to find coverage if the tower's not close by. So, exactly.
And then one last question. A lot of the older towers that we see when there's a tornado, when there's a high windstorm, fall down, crash buildings. It's my understanding now that they're designed in a way that they snap. They don't go beyond that 100 feet
right
diameter. So homes are protected in general, and that you use a substantial amount of concrete in the base so things don't pull out in storms. Is that true?
Yeah, the monopole tower design is basically has a 50% tower height fall zone. So this particular tower at 100 feet would have a 50-foot fall zone. You know, talking to Public Works, they had comments and, you know, were worried about that. The nearest home is 103 feet from the base of the tower, and the pool building and things are there as well. So we provided a letter from the tower manufacturer that spelled out that fall zone for you.
What is the average height of the towers in Bellevue?
I think most of them average around anywhere 80 to 110 feet. Steve Betts may be able to, he's the one to put them all up over the last 20 years, so Chief Betts may be able to answer that. But
in general, this is pretty consistent with the other towers.
Yeah, very consistent. While I'm up here, I do also want to address, if I'm not mistaken, there is a provision in there to where landscaping will be added within the area to soften up the fencing to create, keep a barrier between the fence. So there will be some landscaping plantings and things of that nature to soften up the fencing.
And then I have a question for our attorney.
What?
Bellevue was sued in 2003. The Telecommunications Act, which I think fell under President Clinton, and I have no concept of time, but I think that was probably about the time. 96, thank you. Basically, the city council refused a tower based on citizen concerns, which is obviously very valid. And what happened is we were taken to court, and it did make it all the way to the Supreme Court. And not only did we lose, but we lost badly. And what I saw when I read through all the legal information was that basically there was one case that had managed to get through the courts and be successful, but there were like 10 cases that were unsuccessful and were always in favor of the tower company. And the reason they're always in favor of the tower company is that once a community puts up cell towers, they have to have a valid reason to deny another tower. And a valid reason can't, unfortunately, just be health concerns. Because what happens in court is we're told, well, if you have health concerns now for this tower, how come you didn't for the other 20 towers that you put up? So that's not a substantial argument. You can't say it's environmental because they want to know why with the other 20 towers did you not address those environmental issues. So one of the concerns that I have for us, Pat, is not only did we lose, but we lost a lot. It cost the city of Bellevue a substantial amount of money to fight that. Do you think that this is still something that if we did vote no and we were taken to court, and I know you want to say we could win anything because you're our lawyer, but but would you say that I'm barking up the right tree when I say that?
I think the biggest problem with the 2003 situation is there wasn't a legitimate basis for the denial. If they've gone through the process and they've gone through the engineering and so forth, the council has to articulate a legal, legitimate basis for the denial. There could be an issue where, for instance, under our code, it requires that we look at co-location first, and the applicant has to prove that there is not another tower in which they can co-locate for the purpose of what they're using it for. That would be a reason that we could show it. We could show, based upon our engineers reporting some substantial problem or issue, something like that, that's going to give you a legitimate basis for you to deny it. But you are right in the sense that we do have these in other parks. We do have them in similar locations. There has to be a specific purpose or reason outside of we just decided not to do it in this area. And so that's kind of where you get under the gun. In mentioning that on the engineer, by the way, I think I've shared more emails with Joe Coyle than I have my wife in the last year. We've been working on this for over a year. And this has been vetted out by both the planning department and the engineering department for several months. So this has been well researched and a lot of cooperation and adjustments and so forth have been made both by the tower company and the city to make this work and be as least intrusive as possible.
Councilmember Priester.
Thank you, Councilmember Cook. My concern is about the co-locating of the tower. What options do we have for that? Because I hear Jason talking about taking property that's currently parkland. Kids that are playing in that land will no longer have access to it. I hear unsightliness. I hear a tall tower in a relatively flat, low area, and you want it tall to be able to get the communication going effectively. So I get that. I get that we use it. I can't be a hypocrite. I'm one of those people that you, although old-fashioned, I still have that. But I'm looking at some compromise, and tonight, if I have to vote on it, I'm not going to vote for it because I haven't seen that compromise that maybe has already taken place. But the design of the towers can be different, so they're not so unsightly. I've seen some that look like trees. I think we need a little negotiating with the neighbors, and I'm suggesting we don't do that tonight, but give you and the neighbors an opportunity to have some discussions, see what you can come up with, and at our next meeting, then we address it. I would offer you an opportunity to respond back about the co-locating, the appearance, and what options might be available there, what alternative sites, so we're not using good parkland that we're taking away from kids. Because I'm sensitive to the neighbors, I'm sensitive to the kids playing in parks, and I want to find some middle ground.
Sure. When this started, there aren't any co-location opportunities available. As I mentioned before, the search area for capacity site is very specific. It basically only included the park and the school. As I said, there would not be another private land. There were no other opportunities. The school was not interested. That's when I approached the city.
What was the reason for the school not being interested?
I can address that. The playground that's at that school is fairly small, that when they put it in, that it was going to take up such a significant space for the school that there wasn't going to be enough playground space. Additionally, there were some elevation issues, and so the tower had to be located fairly close, right up against the building, and it was somewhat of an impediment for the kids going out for recess and otherwise.
Space availability, just like at our park.
Right, so then we moved our focus to the park. We had originally proposed a 75 by 75 compound, which working with Public Works on their comments has been scaled down to 60 by 60. So it's not as if we're taking up that entire green space there. And the initially proposed 120 foot tall monopole came down to 100 feet. That was to meet setback requirements. So we came down in height there to meet zoning and not ask for a variance on the height. So those were a couple of the things that we've done so far. And then of course, a board-on-board fence versus standard chain link, landscaping around that and things of that nature since we are in a park. And now there would be room for two additional co-locators in the future, at least two. That could go on this tower.
Saying is you've made some concessions on the size of the footprint in the park, reduce that from 75 to 60 feet. You're also, instead of doing the chain link fence, doing what kind of wood fence or what kind of structure?
That was a wooden fence.
Okay. And you addressed the co-location. The other issue is I assume there are going to be a number of, at the top of the pole, antennas or other things. What about dressing it up so it's not quite as unsightly?
We hadn't addressed that. This is just a standard monopole for the capacity sites. You do need quite a bit of equipment up there, a couple extra remote radio units up there along with the antennas. If you try to scale it down too much, let's say try to go with a flush mount design or something of that nature, then you lose some of that ability to put the equipment that is needed there, and the site won't meet the network needs. So the way it's designed now as a monopole, obviously that's the least obtrusive type of tower. You know, it's not a guide tower or a self-support tower or anything like that, you know, in a residential or park. We're going to do a monopole. But, you know, as far as, you know, any kind of stealth design, that was not proposed.
I understand.
Right.
And I'm asking, I think, could it be? And I, before you answer that, maybe I should ask Jason to come back up and see if there are, from the neighbor's perspective, some options for compromise. Because I think at this point, you're saying you've done it all already. But I don't know if there is still some room. So.
Thank you very much for speaking on my behalf. It gives me a warm fuzzy that somebody here cares for what we as citizens, you know, deal with. This is going to be 103 feet from my house. It's 100 feet tall. That's significant. And then also, there's this large compound, which he's saying he's going to put up to three towers in at some point. And he's going to be happy to do that.
I think it would be others on the single tower.
Oh, okay, I got you. So it's going to be down. My question is, why does there have to be a compound? If we really have to have this pole here, why do you have to have a compound around it? Why can't it be, you know, the least intrusive and maybe put it on the edge of the park so that the kids can still play in the field there? I mean, right now, looking at the design, it looks horrible. There's this giant compound in the middle of the park, you know, with a 100-foot pole sticking out of the middle of it. If you had it at the edge of the park and there was no compound, it wouldn't be quite as big of a deal. And maybe if it was, I don't know, dressed up a little bit, I'm not saying that it has to be a palm tree necessarily, but something a little bit nicer would be nice, you know?
Aesthetically pleasing.
Right, exactly. I mean, if there was some kind of choice in this, that would be very nice for us. And we're going to take a huge property value hit when this thing goes up. I mean, it's in my yard pretty much, with it being 100 feet tall, 100 feet away. It feels like it's in the yard.
So if we were to take what I'm hearing you say as a compromise and move it to another location in the park, would we be then just moving the problem to your neighbor or somebody that's then going to be close to it?
I think that if you looked around, you might find a better place. But I think the big thing is the compound and the fact that it's in the center of one of the areas. If it was at the edge of one of the areas and it was not inside of a compound, I would not be as opposed to it. It would be slightly unsightly and it would decrease my property value, but it wouldn't just be this crushing, you know, prison-like structure sitting right next to my house with a huge pole.
And I think that's fair, and I hope that we can work something like that out and relocate it. If it can stay in the park and be in a more appropriate location, that to me is a good compromise.
I agree. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilmember Carmichael.
Thank you, Councilmember Cook. Point of order, too. We're in public session. We limited it to 5 minutes per person that wanted to get up from the public and speak, so I would appreciate it if we would allow the public to speak instead of having the battle back and forth on the discussion at this point. I know there's several people here to speak about this topic.
Okay, if anybody else
would
like
to say one more thing real quick?
please.
No.
The motivation behind this was part of the strategic planning as well, looking for unique ways to generate some additional revenue and also reduce the amount of mowing in the parks and things of that nature. So this seemed kind of like an obvious thing for us to consider, which is why it's being presented for you today. Also, it's also to service the community as a whole or that neighborhood as a whole when it comes to the data usage in that community. That neighborhood, the data continues to be increase demand because it's no longer just your cell phone, it's iPads and laptops and the data capacity seem to be a need down there as well. So,
thank you.
Good
Good evening. My name is Teresa Wallens, W-A-L-E-N-Z. And I reside at 12724 South 38th Street, and I will be moving into that area. Okay, for the record, I'm here for my parents, Lowell and Doris Stokes, who are in the chairs. We all oppose the placement of the monopole at the proposed location at Jerry Gilbert Park and Pool. My mother actually has owned the house at 505 Beeman Drive since 1969. That's 46 years invested in that neighborhood. I'm 46. I grew up in that house. I'm moving around the corner of it. And it's going to affect the other house that she owns at 2811 Jackson Street. That's two houses that she owns that I know will actually affect the value of the property. I was a realtor for 10 years, licensed in the state of Nebraska, and I moved on and did mortgages for years. So, currently, Jerry Gilbert Park consists of a park, a playground, a basketball court, and a bridge that crosses over a natural drainage reservoir that we played in as kids, but it has the pool with an outbuilding and a large parking lot and a large amount of green space. And that's what we're referring to right tonight is the green space. Currently, the general neighborhood area land use to zoning as follows. To the north, single family residential. To the east, single family residential. To the south, single family residential. And to the west, park and single family residential. I think we're all in agreement that we're all around a bunch of houses. Basically, Jerry Gilbert Park is surrounded by single-family residential properties. Jerry Gilbert Park is exactly a park with open green space. You are being asked to approve placing not only a 100-foot monopole, but with equipment shelter on it with an in the open green space, taking away a 60-by-60 parcel. This land that is undeveloped has no buildings or other building structures. It has a bench that will be removed. And it's my understanding that a mature tree is to be cut down for this as well. Open space provides recreational areas for residents and helps enhance the beauty and environment quality of neighborhoods. You will be taking away this from the residential neighbors on all sides of this park. And I do want to read section 6.06 of the zoning ordinance requires no conditional use permit shall be granted unless the Planning Commission or City Council has found, and I'm going to refer to 6.06.02, that the conditional use will not be injurious to the use and enjoyment of the of other property in the immediate vicinity for the purpose already permitted, nor substantially diminish and impair property values within the neighborhood. That's clear cut. And I truly believe that this monopole is going to make a big difference in the community. It is going to stand out in the green area and diminish the value. The structure also has a proposed 6-foot lightning rod on top, which has not even been discussed. Is there a reason why nobody's talked about that? Leading it to be 105 feet above ground after I did my research. So we're not talking just a 100-foot monopole. The first proposed equipment shelter being roughly 11 by 25 with only a 6-foot wooden fence to cover it up. The only proposed landscaping that I did see was on the south side, which is on the side where the pool is at. So when you're driving down 29th Street, all you're going to see is this big, huge wooden compound with a huge pole. Can't cover that up with too much bushes. As other carriers join, they'll all be allowed to have their own equipment shelters. As you see in the designs that you had for the meeting tonight, there is a reason, there's area for two other shelters for the existing or to add on to different carriers such as Sprint or whoever. Also, the Public Works Department is exploring the possibility of possibly closing down the adjacent road, 30th Avenue, for safety concerns for traffic in the area, which is another change that would happen to the park, leading one road in, one road out. So They've also requested a 12-foot wide parking easement that's dedicated and striped off for the tower compound vehicles. A generator fuel tank will also be on site. In addition to this, there'll be a lot of digging and destroying of the land, and the transformer will be installed for this monopole. In conclusion, I truly believe that when Jerry Gilbert donated this land to the city of Bellevue, he did not intend for the city to allow them to make money off the land that was intended for green space. To the residents surrounding this beautiful park. And I understand that the city of Bellevue will earn a minimum of $2,500 beginning when the monopole is erected and started leasing. As they add carriers, then I'm sure that that amount will go up. And my concern is that not only will it affect the value of the homes, it will affect the green space. And I can only imagine a child throwing a Frisbee over that fence. What do you think they're gonna wanna do to get their Frisbee? That's green space, that's Frisbee space. That's not somebody on a swing, it's a green space. And I don't think that it belongs in the park. So, thank you for listening tonight.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak for or against?
My name's John Reisinger. I live in 503 Beeman Drive, straight across to that parking lot. And one of the individuals up there was saying he was rather old-fashioned. I've been living in that house for 41 years. If they put a tower up there and I'm driving at night, how am I going to find my way home? That's not funny. That's serious. It's going to be looking straight out my backyard. There's a tower. And thank you, City Ambassador. I can't quite read your name. I really understood you very well. I'm really hard of hearing, and you come across very good. I appreciate that. Thank you. And one last thing. I have first impressions about everybody. First impressions about everybody. The gentleman over there, all due respect to him, the last city planner meeting, he stated, I will stay after the meeting and answer any questions. He left before the meeting was over. So here I am out there running down the street, tracking him down to ask him a question, and that's okay, never mind. So I oppose it. I thought that first was a little joke for a senior citizens there, right?
Would anyone else like to speak? Yeah. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Hi, I'm Nancy Wisdom, and I live at 2812 Jackson Street. And I look out my window, and I love the beauty of the neighborhood. Now I'm going to be looking directly at the tower. And I oppose it.
Thank you.
My name is Scott Marr. I live at 501 Beeman Drive. There's been an awful lot of things that have been said, probably much more eloquently than I can this evening. Your name, sir, I really appreciate everything you had to ask and say. It almost seems as though this thing's already been etched in the books, as though we're just you know, relaxing here and just. Stating things that mean nothing. I think what's been said this evening so far is all about the view of the park, the value that we value this neighborhood at. Seeing this tower go up here, I have a hard time believing that nothing else has been researched. Nowhere else has been thought of. I think not even four blocks down south, just straight south of there would be just fine. I mean, where that creek runs, it runs all the way down to the south. There's all sorts of land just to the south of this. It doesn't have to be right in the middle of the park. I don't have cable TV. I just have regular TV, so I don't know what this is going to do to my TV reception either. Am I going to have to start paying for cable now that this thing goes up? I don't know. But that's neither here nor there. I guess the main thing is, why put this tower right in the middle of this park? You know, parks are kind of precious in the neighborhood. They're precious to people. They're precious to the kids. And I see the kids playing over there all the time. At least they've got a place to go. And now you're just making it smaller, you know? We got to keep the places where the kids go. Keeps them out of trouble. And that's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm opposed, by the way.
Thank you.
My name is Doris Stokes, and my husband and I have lived in the area for 40-some years. And I definitely oppose it. I know kids have been playing in that area even before it was a park or a swimming pool. And to me, when the city thinks they're going to build a monopole to have revenue for the city, they're definitely not thinking of our children and the next generation. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? Seeing no one coming forward, I'm going to close the public hearing. Is there any other comments by the council? Oh, Mr. Coyle, would you come up and address some of the concerns that have been brought forward?
Thank you. To touch on the actual location in the park, you know, And Mr. Shuchuk could probably comment on this as well. I think that is the best location in the park. It's not at the entry of the park. And the gentleman mentioned if it was at one end that it would possibly be better. Well, it is at that far southern tip of that green space. You know, we stuck it in that corner best we could there. The playground, the basketball goal and things are on the other side of the drainage ditch there, so we're not near those things where the kids do play. Some things were mentioned about property values as well. Though I didn't do an evaluation for this particular site, we do property valuations for sites. Done some in Nebraska, and the outcome of those is that a monopole tower does not affect a property value negatively, that in fact, it's looked at as just infrastructure, the same as a water tank or utility poles, things of that nature. That's what the real estate professionals in Nebraska, where we're putting some more of these capacity sites in residentially zoned areas, have come up with. The woman mentioned the 5-foot lightning rod. We just typically don't talk about that in terms of height. It's a very narrow piece of metal. I think we all know what a lightning rod is. So it's not really visible on a 100-foot pole. So we just don't typically in industry talk about the lightning rod is in the height. There will be landscaping around the entire perimeter of the fence, not just on one side. Public Works did talk about maybe closing off one end of the park there, the access. That is a safety issue. People cut through that parking lot. So that change has nothing to do with whether the tower was going in there or not. That is something that they are looking at in Public Works just to increase safety. Generally in the park. If we were to try to move further south, as the gentleman suggested, we would get too close to that existing Verizon site at the base, so that wouldn't help us out. Interference issues, again, FCC governs that. We can take a look at any type of interference issues that come up. That's part of the it's part of the lease document that would be signed, is that interference issues would have to be taken care of. And just for the record, at the Planning Commission meeting, I did not say that I would stick around and talk to people afterwards, but I would be more than happy to. And when Mr. Reisinger talked to me in the hallway and again out on the street, I was explaining to him what the pole would look like, and I pointed there to Central Elementary, where one had just been constructed. So I suggested that if he wanted to take a look at that one, then he would know, exactly what we were talking about here tonight. There's some communities, you may have read the minutes from the Planning Commission hearing, just to throw those stats out again, 450,000 911 calls per day in America, 40% of our households now in the United States don't have a landline. They simply carry cell phones as their means of communication. And 2014 was the first time that people accessed the internet on their phones more than they did on their desktop computers. So those are the things that are driving these capacity sites and the usage where people are and where they're using their devices, is causing us to come to places, public use places such as churches, parks, city-owned properties like that, that's near where the demand is greatest. One of the residents mentioned, it's a bad idea for the children and the next generation. Well, as your assistant city administrator mentioned, iPads, phones, that's what our children are using, up to 3 or 4 devices in a household at the same time. And that's what's driving this capacity site too. So that would take care of my rebuttal. I think I covered most of the points that I heard.
Council Member Blood?
Ultimately, if this tower didn't go up, what would that mean for the cell phone users?
The public safety aspect is absolutely there.
Outside the 911, what hardships does it create? And I'm sincere, what hardships does it create, if any, for existing cell phone users if that tower doesn't go up?
The other towers nearby would go to exhaust, because they would be there would be too much usage, too much data usage.
What does exhaust mean?
To exhaust would mean that it is not working at the level that it was designed to work at, because the network is basically overloaded in that location. So the capacity allows the device to use all of the bells and whistles, if you will, that it has, allows you to download things, watch movies on your phone without it buffering, and things of that nature.
So it's more of a convenience issue and a economic benefit for your company?
An economic benefit for the city of Bellevue. It's basically they're providing a service to the city. It's telecommunication infrastructure. There are towns that aren't as lucky as you are here that send out RFPs to the companies begging them to please, build towers in our town so that people can use their phones.
But as the third largest city in Nebraska, we don't have that issue. Then the other question, the only other question I have for you, is that you quoted that in your research that the towers don't affect the value of property. Can you cite what your resource is for that?
That report, I have it on my computer. That was done, a study done by a gentleman named Jim Bain, a real estate appraiser, and that was for a tower that was going to residential neighborhood in McCook, Nebraska.
You know who paid for that study?
SBA Communications.
Okay, thank you.
Are you? Mr. Bernal?
Yeah, Mr. Coyle, one of the concerns that was brought up was the size of the compound. Could you speak to why the dimensions need to be of a certain size and for what purpose?
Right, your ordinance requires future co-location. So the 60 by 60 will allow at least two more co-locators there. And besides the ordinance, of course, the lease that's been negotiated, the resident was correct in saying as future carriers go on there, that would increase revenue to the city.
Councilmember Hanson, I'm drawing a blank.
Thank you, Mayor Sanders.
All right.
I guess I look at this, I grew up right down in that section of town. I think the average lots are probably 46 by 147. I mean, the houses are close together there. That park is, I don't want to say it's not that large. And I really kind of oppose putting these towers into residential areas. Not too long ago, I wasn't sure if it was you, but we had them looking at Pilgrim's Landing with Pilgrim's Church, and there was such an uproar of those folks out there that they basically said, we're going to forget it, and they went to another area. So I oppose it entirely about putting them in residential areas. I just thought I'd state that. So.
Thank you. Councilmember Carmichael.
Thank you, Councilmember Cook. From a person that represents that area and grew up in that area and played in those parks, they're few and far between down there. You made a statement about this benefiting our children, allowing them to play with laptops and cell phones. So does that park. That park is their only place down there where they can really play. And from the perspective of representing my constituents down there, I've had so many calls. As a matter of fact, every single call I've had has been against this, and I cannot support this proposal for you.
Thank you. Councilmember Blood.
I just want to caution council when we vote, that's when we say whether in favor or not in favor. But Pat, if indeed council members end up being in favor of not putting up this site because we want to prevent frivolous lawsuits that used to cost the city hundreds of thousands of dollars because council didn't always have the foresight to prevent these lawsuits. In order to deny, we have to have a written explanation. Is that correct?
You don't have to have a written explanation, but my suggestion would be at this point that you table this or postpone any action on this for 2 weeks so I can review this based on what I'm hearing.
I don't understand. Based on what you're hearing, what do you mean?
Lack of support.
The concerns raised by the council.
Well, why would that? I'm sorry. I know this sounds smart alecky, and I don't mean it that way. Why would that change anything, with the exception of the legal issue that concerns me?
Because you're raising legal issues that I have not investigated.
I'd like to make a couple comments and some questions, Chris, Mr. Shuchuk, the lady, Teresa, I believe was her name, Walls. She brought up she brought up some of the city code. I guess it's not code, but in reference to uses of parks. And part of my notes was, does this fit the actual use and purpose of a city park? And I know she did go down to a section. I don't have it in front of me, so I can't repeat it. What's the?
I can give it to you.
Well, just hang on for a minute.
Oh, okay.
Chris, you probably don't have it in front of you, but. Yep. Could you give it to Mr. Shuchuk, just
yes,
real quick?
Yes, 6.02.
Do you have that, Chris?
Yes, and that's part of the staff report that everybody has in their packet. Mm-hmm. It states that the conditional use will not be injurious to the use and enjoyment of other property in the immediate vicinity for the purpose already permitted, or substantially diminish and repair property values within the neighborhood.
Thank you, ma'am.
Can I say one more thing?
We closed public hearing.
Okay, all right.
I'm sorry. Part of my concern is we brought up this road. I did live on 30th Avenue many years ago before the pool was built. And I will tell you that living on that street, I would not support the possibility of that roadway being closed. I know that was put in the Planning Commission minutes that that was a possibility. I think we make it more unsafe living on that road and not having a turnaround. You get big vehicles and stuff like that, having to back up that street would be much more unsafe. And I think this location of this pole adds to that safety issue. If you were coming down 30th Avenue and as you would go through a 6-foot wooden fence, that pole there, I think would cause obstruction. It would actually probably be more of a safety issue. I would like to see where we do some more, Mr. Coyle, things with these poles. I was at a football field in the Omaha area, and they had a pole like this that also acted as lights on the football field. Some people, you know, lights in the park. I don't know what other purposes there are for these poles to try to use them, but to me, I think we got to look at other possibilities of the way these poles look, and also what can also go on to help maybe the immediate area. Now, I realize that shouldn't be on financially on you, but I thought it was great to see a football field probably have 6 big lights, and 2 of them actually were poles for, they had antennas and they had those things on them, and I thought that was great. About a year and a half ago, I asked if somehow we could look at Bellevue as a total. Where are we looking at putting these poles? And let's not piecemeal this. Let's not put one here and then wonder, we sit here and say, okay, where's the next one gonna go? I think we need to look at Bellevue as a whole and probably our SIDS as a whole to where someone can come to us and say, you know, for the next 20 years of coverage, you're gonna need to put in 10 poles, and here's where they will likely need to be so that we can see a bigger picture, so that if a pole's next to my house, I know there might be a pole next to your house as we look at the whole, and with a good purpose, so that we can look at the big picture. And I just think you've been here before the council before, and I would like to see something as a whole where the future, and I realize there's other businesses, but where does the future look like to where we're gonna have to continue to add these poles? We all wanna use our cell phones. And I think in our older built out neighborhoods, it's going to be schools and parks and churches. I don't know any other thing that would have a large amount of green space. So we got to make a decision. Are we going to use these cell phones for every possible thing, or are we going to, and I don't see this turning backwards and going back to where we were at. But I would like to see something to where we have a general idea throughout the city and into our ETJ to where we have an idea where all these poles are going to be, so that as a community we can see that. I got another, I'm trying to go through a whole bunch of messy notes. I know that the contract addresses if there's other cohabitats or whatever on that pole. Part of my concern is, this came up when I was on the Sarpy County Board, and I tell you, I went out to a pole on 36th Street and I stood next to it. And I'm telling you, they are pretty intimidating when you're very close to them. And also, I think there was some fans. I'm sure there's computers and a lot of electronics in there. And I know there's a noise level, but I can tell you standing within 10, 15 feet of that fence, I could hear fans and humming noises coming from them. And I would think, you know, one is gonna cause X amount of noise, two is probably gonna double it, and three is probably gonna triple it. So there might be an issue. I don't like the location where you're picking in this park because I think it's a safety issue. I think people coming down 30th Avenue, kids on bikes, people driving cars, I think if it has to go in this park, I think there would be better location. It might be a little bit more expensive to put up because of the terrain and the slope there, but we put towers on top of buildings. We put towers everywhere. I think this is the best place for your company to put a tower, but I think there's other places in that park that a tower may be suitable for. I'm not an expert. I'm just saying I don't like where it's at because I think it's a safety issue. That park's priority is kids. And if we have a safety concern, I think it needs to be addressed. I'd like to continue this. I'd like you to maybe get with the neighbors that have been here and talk to them. If this is the only place it can go, and to try to work with them to maybe try to locate it somewhere else. That's my comments. Anybody else? Councilmember Blood?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion since public hearing has been closed.
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion that we continue this until the August 24th meeting to explore the legal ramifications of a potential denial.
Could I talk you into making that the first meeting in September?
Here's my issue, Pat.
Yes or no, that's all I'm saying.
I just feel like we put things off and, you know, either we're doing something right or we're doing something wrong. Is it because it's going to put you under the gun to do the research?
It's a short window to get that research done.
I'd like to see it by the 24th, unless somebody wants to amend my motion.
I will say a motion fails for no second. Would anybody else like to make a motion? Councilmember Carmichael?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to deny the ordinance or the request for the conditional use permit.
I'll second that.
I have a motion by Councilmember Carmichael, seconded by Councilmember Hansen. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote no.
It's a motion to deny.
I vote yes. Thank you.
All voted yes to deny.
Clarify.
Item number, that was for the condition, what did we vote on?
You voted on the approval of the conditional use permit.
So now 10A2?
I'm mute.
Pat? We'll vote on 10A2.
Well, you still deny that as well. Or whatever you want to do. It's still an agenda item.
I need a motion on 10A2. Councilmember Carmichael?
I'll make a motion to deny the approval of the conditional use permit.
Second.
Second.
The optional, yeah, you got it.
So the motion is on?
On 10A2, motion to deny the approval of the option and land lease memorandum.
Motion by Councilmember Carmichael, second by Councilmember Modry. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes to deny.
Item number 11, resolutions none. Item number 12, A, B, C, D were approved under consent agenda. Item number 12E, approval of the annual service agreement and e-verify addendum to Vertair for the continued maintenance and service of the police simulator in the amount of $33,388 to be paid with federal forfeiture money. Councilmember Blood.
Motion to approve in the amount of $33,388 to be paid with federal forfeiture money.
Second.
Motion made by Councilmember Blood, second by Councilmember Preister. Any further discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
Item 12F, acceptance of the bid for demolition of the condemned structure at 1101 Schilling Drive by Polonsic Construction and Trucking Company in the amount of $9,995. Motion, Mr. Carmichael.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion for approval of the acceptance of the bid of demolition of the condemned structure at 1101 Schilling Drive by Polonsic Construction and Trucking Company in the amount of $9,995.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Carmichael, second by Councilmember Blood. Any discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
Item number 12G, approval of the bid and authorization for the mayor to sign a contract with Chiaco Roofing.
Chacho
Roofing. Thank you. To replace the roof at the District 1 fire station in the amount of $157,900. Councilmember Blood.
A motion to approve in the amount of $157,900.
Second.
Motion made by Councilmember Blood, second by Councilmember Carmichael. Any discussion? Hearing none, please vote. I vote yes.
All voted yes.
12G, reconsideration of the approval and authorization of the mayor to sign the agreement and e-verify addendum with HGM Associates for survey and engineering services for Highway 370 and Fort Crook Road South, not to exceed $21,500, as was approved at the July 27th, 2015 City Council meeting. Councilmember Mulgrew.
Thank you, Council President Cook. Excuse me. get a drink of water. I asked that this be put on the agenda for reconsideration after our vote on July 27th to approve this. I didn't feel right about my vote that night, and it bothered me quite a bit. I didn't sleep for a couple nights. Reason being, we have a tight budget situation. I know this isn't a lot of money for the study itself, but we do have $600,000 from state of Nebraska for maintenance of that bridge in the budget. There are no funds or anything beyond that if we decided to replace the bridge or do away with it. I know that would be several hundred thousand dollars impact for us to do that. There's nothing in the budget for the next 2 years. So I guess my thought is that I don't see the need really for the study at this time, knowing that we won't be able to act on it for at least those 2 years. And anything to save us a little bit, at least, towards our budget be welcome at this point.
Councilmember Preister.
Thank you, Council President Cook. I appreciate cost savings. However, I don't want us to be penny wise and pound foolish, because I think this is excellent investment, and I think this design was wrong. I think it's going to cost way more than $600,000, and I would like our Public Works Director, Jeff Roberts, to maybe give us some additional information or re-educate us on why we're even doing this, because we need to have an assessment, and before we put anything into it, we need to know what we're doing. And I think that's what we have budgeted some money to help staff do. So, Mr. Roberts, would you please?
Yeah, first of all, let me make a little clarification. This is for survey only. My team is going to do the assessment and put the report and study together. This bridge is 25, 26 years old. It was constructed starting in 1989, finished in 1991. Excuse me, my voice is going. The lifespan, based on the design technology in the 1980s, this bridge is probably closer to only having a lifespan of 50 years, not 70. For design today, you'd get closer to that 70-year mark. Lifespan of a concrete deck is 20 to 25 years. It's already outlived its life on the concrete, so eventually in the next few years it's going to have to be redecked. Sarpy County is preparing to redeck a bridge that's approximately 350 linear feet. The estimated cost is $900,000. Our bridge is 390 linear feet. The cost is going to be over $1 million to redeck it. The MSC retaining walls are they proved to be less than an ideal product when they brought those into the construction world. What we're doing here is we're just trying to band-aid this for $300,000. That's just plugging the holes and filling the voids that are in there. These MSC walls won't last anywhere near the life of the bridge. They hide problems, granular backfill leaks, creating unseen voids. The city of Omaha will not use this type of design anymore and is in the process of eliminating the ones they have. The approach labs are getting settling potentially from the voids behind the MSC wall, and the cost to replace and bring it up to industry standards is about $300,000. To remove these MSC walls is probably closer to $1 million. So we're looking at maintenance costs of about $2.4 million within the next few years. If you take this bridge and just replace the bridge itself today, and not the road or anything with it, based on the numbers and inflation of 3% for 25 years. To replace this bridge costs $2.8 million. So you're almost spending as much in maintenance costs as if you would replace the bridge, take away tearing it down and building that great intersection. So that's what I'm looking at, is this cost-benefit ratio. And where are we going to be in the next few years? Because we have to have a plan of action on all our bridges. If this deck starts to crumble and we shut down this road, we can't react at that time. What are we going to do now? All I'm trying to do is prepare an assessment like, when this case happens, here's what we need to do. So we have a plan in place already.
And I appreciate that answer. It's an excellent answer, and it's what I think the city needs to do more of. We need to plan for the future and not just look immediately at a cost savings. To look at what the figures are that you gave us, I think, is pretty impressive to me, to keep the approval as it stands and not to reconsider. Thank you.
And just to clarify one more thing, too. It wasn't my intent to say we're going to tear the bridge down and put an at grade. That was just an option. That was just one thing that came up. So I want to make that clear, too, that there's been no decision whatsoever. I think the press has kind of blown this out of proportion a little bit. We're just trying to see what is the best fit for this intersection. Maybe the bridge, it may be an at-grade intersection, but that's what this feasibility study will help to determine.
Councilmember Carmichael.
Thank you, Councilmember Cook. I think we all have a frog in our throat tonight. Jeff, I understand the cost that you brought up on this issue. I understand what the survey is for. I guess I have to go back to when the city was evaluating the offer from the state of Nebraska. Why didn't we catch this then? Why did we take this bridge and all of a sudden we've got all these costs associated with maintaining a structure that was poorly designed, poorly constructed, and now it's sitting square in the citizens of Bellevue's lap?
Well, that's a good question. Those conditions weren't assessed on the bridge at the time the money was brought in. Now, maybe the state knew about it, I'm not sure, but they gave us enough money to fix the approach slabs, just plug up the walls, fill in the voids, and that's how much money they said was going to need. If they hadn't relinquished it, this was all the work they were going to do to it, to make it more of a simple answer.
And at some point, they would have had to face the ultimate cost of significant repairs to their bridge because it would have started to collapse and fail. Hearing you say is true.
Yeah, in a few years, that probably would have happened. They would have had to expend more money on it to get it back up to today's standards.
Mr. Roberts, you made a statement that you believe within the next couple of years we're going to have to redeck it for, I think you said, a little bit over $1 million. Or?
That's quite possible. I mean, you could probably maybe squeeze a few more years out of it, but if it does start to happen in a couple of years, we got to be prepared for it. And it's past its life already. It's 1 year past its life.
What do you think the cost would be to make that a normal intersection out?
Well, that's one of the things I'm going to look into. They do have a highway safety program at the state of Nebraska. And because of the way this thing was designed with the on-ramps having a blind merge, I think I can make a case to make this a highway safety project that's 90% funded by the state, 10% by the city. Just rough numbers that we threw together to make this an at-grade intersection, you're probably looking, and I'm throwing in anywhere from 35 to 50% contingencies, we're looking at about $5.5 to $7 million.
Mr. Berlewitz?
One thing I want to add is, in terms of the relinquishment of Highway 370, that wasn't like a discretionary. That came with the opening of the new Highway 34 bridge. State of Nebraska has a rule where they do not take on additional lane miles. So when the bridge opened up with the additional lane miles they took on, that automatically turned that existing section of Highway 370 over to us. the funds that we received were the dollars that they were planning to spend on maintenance and repair of it. So that's how that came about.
Was there any engineering analysis of that bridge that would have verified what Jeff is telling us that we should have known about?
I can't say, Jeff. Can
they
you?
Never finished any structural plans until after the relinquishment. We were able to get a hold of some bridge plans, but they weren't complete. Once they were going to relinquish it, they stopped doing all the work on the project they were going to do.
So during their analysis and their development of their plans, they didn't know that there was structural deficiencies with the bridge, is what you're saying?
Well, I can't answer that. I don't know what they had or what information they had. You know, they just had the three areas, or the two areas they're going to work on, the approach slabs and the retaining walls. Nothing else as far as decking or anything of that.
Councilmember Preister.
We can blame the state, and we can look at what the state should have done, but we asked the state to give us a new highway. They built a bridge. We used federal dollars. We used state dollars. We didn't put that much money in Highway 34, and all that construction that's all brand new. We got what we asked for. The state simply takes the old highway and turns it over to the local jurisdiction. They don't go through, to my knowledge, and do a complete assessment and then a cost-benefit analysis on what they're going to give to the city or to the municipality that's going to inherit it. They simply give them a large sum of money to allow just immediate maintenance and care. So if you want that changed, you need to go to the legislature and see about getting that changed. But we got a far greater benefit, and we have an opportunity to get 90% of it paid for a new one through the safety program that Mr. Roberts is telling us about. I don't see this as all that bad. I see it as some opportunity here. But in order to get to that opportunity, we need to do some assessment. And that's all what we passed will do. $21,000, I agree. I want to look at every penny and not spend it foolishly. This is an excellent investment, to my view.
Mr. Sullivan?
Not to bring up Robert's rules, but we really don't have a motion on the floor. So if somebody wants to make a motion, then we can discuss it further. But that's probably what we need first.
Mr. Preister?
I move to deny the reconsideration of the approval.
I think what we would need is someone on the moving that won on the last motion, or when we approved it 2 weeks ago, to make a motion to reconsider.
Okay.
And so, well, right, but there would be a motion actually to reconsider as opposed to a motion to deny the reconsideration.
And if there is no motion, then it just dies,
then
too.
It dies.
My feeling is what Mr. Roberts has brought to our attention, we got some immediate concerns probably in the next couple of years. I think we almost need to have it surveyed and engineered and looked at to know where we actually stand. The state did turn over $2.5 million. We used part of that to do the resurfacing out from basically Betts Road to the interstate, I guess. So, you know, we're going to run into a problem. Hopefully, maybe that the program through the state, maybe we can get some funds from them down the road. But I think we need to at least get it assessed. I know we're going to do some in-house work on it to know what the actual condition and maybe the length of that bridge is going to be as far as the use before we have to do major repairs or demolish it. Thank you. Mr. Modrey.
Thank you, Council President Cook. In light of the information, I'm glad we had this discussion to get a little more information out, on the situation and the costs involved for maintenance and so forth down the road. Given that, I will not make a motion.
Thank you. Councilmember Preister?
Just want to comment that I hope Councilman Modrey can sleep tonight.
I hear no motion. We'll move to item number 13, City Administrator's Report. Mr. Berlewicz?
Both staff and I are here to answer questions that the council may have.
Mr. Preister?
Thank you, Council President Cook. On the administrator's report under Mr. Burke's information, it lists Fab Tech in Chicago, and I don't see him here now, but Mr. Berlewicz, do you know what that Fab Tech in... Oh, there he is.
There you go.
I'm sorry.
Fab Tech is a international trade show where fabrication and manufacturing companies come in and set up booths and show their wares, if you will. Black Hills Energy was kind enough to invite me along to attend and set at their booth and represent the city of Bellevue, which is somewhat costly. I wouldn't have to pay a registration fee, which is, I believe, close to $700. And the booth space, of course, is one thing, but having the ability to walk the floor and make contacts within that industry with the LB 840 area that we're trying to promote. I just did some research on Fab Tech, how many attendees there were like approximately 10,000 attendees there, and the cost that it would take for me to get there. I filled out a travel request, but Mr. Berlewicz has asked me to wait a little while and be patient with the acceptance or denial of it.
Yeah, I was also, I primarily asked that if there was the potential that if Sarpy County Economic Development Corp is going to attend that, whether there might also be some cost offsetting on that. So as Mr. Burks has made the request, I've not made a decision to approve it yet. So I think he's just indicating that one thing I said was find out what the costs are, find out how, if we do go, how we could make it affordable and cost effective to do so.
And that would be my concern,
yeah.
The value of somebody going and what the additional costs are, what we might get in return.
Right.
So if we're spending something, we want a good investment and we want a return on that.
Right. That's why I haven't approved it yet. I'm asking for the review to see how we can get the best benefit out of it.
And I did find a deal where it was a free airfare if I booked a certain hotel, and that hotel was about $213 a night. So it was very comparable to what was going on within that area. It was also walking distance from the conference center too, but I was just doing the research, trying to be proactive and trying to put my resources to use if I could. It was not, as I said, it's up to Mr. Berlewicz, and whatever he decides, I'll be happy with, so.
Okay, I appreciate the clarification and the clarity. One other item on the administrator's report is the Offutt joint land use study, and Mr. Shuchuk had it in his report. I did look through it, and I was disappointed that I didn't see one of the concerns that I had expressed that was brought to me. Under air quality, there was nothing at all listed, and I had some complaints about jet fuel being dumped or downloaded. I recognize it may just be in emergency situations, but I had reported that there was concern about the jets flying over and where they might, in emergency situations, dump jet air fuel down on people or away from people. And I didn't see that in the report. And what concerns people about that is we have no lead in any gasoline in cars or trucks, but jet aircraft fuel is exempt, and so there's still lead in jet fuel. And so not only do we get the lead falling from the exhaust, but on those occasions when it is dumped just intentionally to get rid of load, we're dumping lead down on people in addition to the fuel. And I was told that the complaint I forwarded on was received and would be acknowledged, but in this last report, I didn't go to the last meeting because I assumed it would be there. When I reread the report, there was no mention at all in there. So my question, Mr. Shuchuk, is how is that recorded? Do I need to go back directly to them? I know you're not conducting the study, but you're on the study group, so I pose it to you.
Can I ask you how you relayed that concern to them?
I emailed it.
Okay.
It was acknowledged that they received it.
Okay. Did you email it to Matt Roth?
Yes.
Okay. I'll follow up on that.
Okay.
And the comment period is still open.
Right. If I need to redo it, I can. But when I was told it was received and would be a part of it, I assumed that that was the case.
I will follow up on that for you tomorrow and
okay.
Let you know. And just for the council's information, the final meeting of the J-Lux committee, I think, is scheduled for the 20th of August, which is a week from Thursday. I plan on attending that meeting.
Thank you. Mr. Berlowitz?
The only thing I wanted to add, or I wanted to point out, included with the administrator's report is a progress report for the second quarter of our strategic plan period. That's something we are automatically doing. Each time we complete a quarter, we'll do a third quarter, and ultimately we'll have a fourth quarter. So, but the second quarter progress report is included with this report.
Thank you.
And I would just finish my comments. I was going to say I appreciate having those quarterly reports, because when we first started, the first year or so, we didn't get those updates, and we were getting to the end of the year and then scrambling. So getting the reminders out to staff and people and getting the updates is something I had asked for, and I do appreciate. Yeah.
And we took into account Councilmember Price's prodding, so we're going to stay on the mark.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item number 14, public request to be heard. I got a statement to read. Any member of the public addressing the council shall abide by council policy resolution number 35 regarding principles of conduct and decorum, which states any statements made during city council meetings by mayor, members of the city council, city officials, and employees, or members of the general public shall not involve personal, impertinent, or slanderous attacks on individuals, regardless of whether the individual so attacked is an elected official, a city official, or an employee, or a member of the general public. And City Code Section 2-68 regarding manner of addressing the council. Copies of the aforementioned rules are posted outside the council chambers. Speakers shall limit their presentations to 5 minutes.
Good evening. I'm Leanne Gifford. I live at 10111 South 11th Street in the Avery Hills area. Some of you may remember I was here for the July 13th meeting because the agenda had been amended to add an executive session item, discussion of fire department staffing issues, and I was objecting to that it was not an appropriate item for executive session. Mr. Cook and Mr. Carmichael agreed with me and moved to have it removed from the agenda. Mr. Berlowitz stated that the subject matter was related to personnel issues and possible litigation, and I believe he said that a couple of times. The item ended up being removed from executive session, and I expected a more appropriately described item to appear at the last council meeting, but there was no executive session, and there's no executive session today either. So apparently, the staffing personnel issue resolved itself or is being ignored. My guess, it's being ignored. Because in the meanwhile, I had made a few requests for public records on the city, asking for the staffing levels of the fire department and for emails regarding the staffing levels. What I was looking for was what prompted that particular item to be put on the agenda. And what I received, to me, is alarming. I mean, I know you guys can't see this. All I can tell you is red is bad, okay? Red means they took a truck out of service. I don't know if it's a fire truck or a rescue squad, but it's out of service. So this is last year. Starting in September, October, November, and December, you have way more red days than you do green days. Green days, everything's fully staffed. There's also some yellow in there, meaning they're running three-man rigs. Three-man rigs are dangerous. For 2015, they changed how they did it because with the part-timers, they run two shifts of 12 hours. So they wanted to see, is it the morning shift, you know, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. that we're having a problem, or 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. that we're having a problem. So you can't see this nearly as well, but I can tell you, the number of green days, in other words, fully staffed for 24 hours in January, 13, February, 8, March, 9, April, 17, woohoo, better than half, May, 13, June, 6, and July, I only have it through the 15th of July, there were 5 days, so one-third of the time they were fully staffed. what I received in the emails showed that regarding the 4th of July weekend, and I know there was some publicity regarding that, that Chief Wagner sent an email to Chief Guido, who forwarded that information to Mr. Berlewitz, who then forwarded it on to the council members, showing that they were going to be significantly understaffed for the 4th of July weekend, the 3rd, the 4th, and the 5th. And the email chain I received, there's some back and forth discussion on stuff, but it ends with Mr. Berlewitz stating that the issue should be discussed in executive session. A paid fire department isn't cheap, but you know what? Firefighters' life isn't cheap either. And the way the fire department's being staffed, from what I can see here, you guys are gonna kill somebody. I mean, just flat out, you're gonna kill somebody. What I see is a grossly underfunded and understaffed fire department, and I want the fire chief to give a full report to the council in open session addressing the staffing levels of the department. I know that on the 13th, he had a number of notebooks with him, enough to hand to each of the council members. So he has a report already prepared. I want him to give that report to the public at the next meeting. You want public input regarding a budget, but the public has to be well informed in order to give a well-reasoned opinion on the budget. And right now, the public has no knowledge of how understaffed the fire department is. And I know that there's been some discussion back and forth and other emails suggesting, well, we could just have the chiefs ride the trucks. Well, that's all well and good, except you're in violation of state law. You can do a bunch of overtime. Well, that's well and good until you run up against federal laws and state laws regarding how much firefighters can work. You need more manpower. You need to hire more people. And I know it's something that is going to be discussed in 2 weeks at the public hearing, but I wanted to let you guys know, to give you a little bit of time to think about it and figure out how you're going to do this. Because the volunteers are not coming back. You know, it's been, what, 6 years that we've had paid people. Omaha has in their budget to hire more, which means we lose more. Lincoln is talking about how they haven't expanded theirs for a number of years, so they're looking to hire more. And Council Bluffs, I heard, might be looking at more also. Every time surrounding communities hire firefighters, we lose. We've spent lots of money investigating in training people, giving them some experience just for them to go elsewhere and get the full-time job that they want. So I will say, the nice thing about the fire department, though, you call 911, they will be there. They may not be there as quickly as you want because they don't have all the trucks, but they will be there to put your pants out.
Thank you. Councilmember Blood?
Since the budget is an agenda issue, Pat, and it was in reference to the budget, I just want to make a statement. I can't speak on behalf of all the council, but I know that I myself met one-on-one with our fire chief. None of this is new information, and I'm guessing to the vast majority of the council, I think we've all had opportunity to meet. We've all had opportunity to see exactly what was just shown at the podium. To infer that this is an issue that's not being addressed and that we're not trying to find funds to address this issue, I think is not correct. And so I just want the public to know that this is something that, again, I can only speak for myself, but I'm pretty confident that the vast majority of the council's been informed of this. thanks to our fire chief, we've seen the reports, we've seen the numbers, and we can address it more when there is public comment at the second reading.
Thank you. Oh, Mr. Sullivan?
Not that there's anything wrong with what you said, but if we start to use the budget as a reason to address the crowd, there's going to be about any item under the sun that could be addressed, and I really don't think that's probably a road we should go down. So.
Mr. Frederick?
Yes, Chuck Frederick, 1511 Madison Street. She was a lot more than 5 minutes, so just keep that in mind. A couple weeks ago, I requested some information from both a city employee and a appointed employee. They're both on my website, and I got written responses back, and it's surprising it still goes on, but they spelled my name wrong twice. Now, when I was when they were trying to recall me in the city council, elected officials and appointed officials and other people were trying to spell my name wrong on purpose, maybe just upset me. But I'm not running for office, but I think I appreciate if you spell my name right. It's F-R-E-D-R-I-C-K. You can see the request on my website, chuckfrederick.com. The other thing that came up the last week was that I talked to some people and they said that, Chuck, there are people going around telling me that you were escorted out of the building at the city council meeting. And I've spoken over 150 times and never been escorted out of the building. So I don't know who's starting that rumor, but I certainly hope that if anybody here is starting it, I hope they stop it. What I do want to talk about is the last meeting. After I got through talking at that meeting for the public request to be heard, Councilman Blood came down and spoke. And to me, I think that's illegal. Maybe it's not a law yet, but maybe it should be. As far as I'm concerned, it was tacky, inappropriate. It circumvented the rules. I have a suggestion. If anybody who is a appointed or elected official comes down and speaks after somebody from the public request is through speaking, I think maybe that should be automatic resignation. That would certainly stop that from happening again. Now, Councilman Blood is by far the best person I've ever seen to get media for herself, both TV and for the paper press. And so kudos to you for doing that. But then when I brought up what I talked about last time about the article in the World Herald, I'm not going to read it again. It's on my website. You can take a look at it. Headlines are, Bellevue Councilwoman says at-large seat poses problem, suggests axing it. I never saw any place like you said where there was any ordinance brought up where the council voted on it. Never saw that at all whatsoever. What the other thing that bothers me is that at the very end, you said, she is cautious to do so, but has become very annoyed by Mr. Frederick giving out misinformation. This article is not misinformation, and I'm annoyed that you keep on coming up and saying I'm giving misinformation. I'm not giving misinformation. I'm willing to talk one-on-one at Channel 17, anybody in this building, anybody, and we can just sit down and talk, see what happens. But I'm not giving misinformation, and I think it's time that people realize that people who accuse me of that are entirely wrong. The other thing, too, is that I did mention for the veterans thing, I mentioned Andy. I didn't know his last name. His last name is Foray. He was his birthday was last Monday, 91 years old. I mentioned before he was on the second wave of the Omaha Beach. And if there is an emblem or a certificate, maybe he can get that. He lives here in Bellevue. He watched city council meeting, but he certainly deserves one. He's a great guy. But thank you for your time, and I think my 5 minutes, look at that. Oh, I forgot to set it, I guess. How about that? But thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name is Doreen Sherman, and I want to thank the city for when you whatever you did to the road that comes into Bellevue, and all the time that you were resurfacing it, you kept it open so we could still drive and not have to worry about finding another way out of town, and I appreciate that. And I appreciate you, City Council, and all that you do for us, and I especially think that we have a great fire department and that we have the best police department and chief police in the state of Nebraska. That's my opinion. And I love Bellevue, and thank you so much for all you all do for us.
Can you sign in?
We might get those compliments on record.
Oops, I'm writing instead of printing. I hope that's all right.
That'll be fine.
I do write legibly.
That's good. Good evening.
I don't know if I can follow her up, but I'll try.
I know next week the budget will be covered, but I was at the July 15th forum, and I was listening to a lot of the citizens that came up and mainly spoke out about the pool, the fire, and the police. And I agree with everything they say, and I wanted to speak out at the following city council meeting, but I had other obligations. I want more fire. I want more police as well. But the sheer problem is we just don't got enough revenue in this city. And unfortunately, Omaha's growing, Council Bluff is growing, Papillion's growing, Ralston, everywhere is growing. If we don't grow, we can't support these people. And our expenses grew 15% from the last budget. It's just going to keep expanding. And I want to have more fire, more police. But I think less than 10 years ago, we had a fully volunteer fire department. I'm not saying they perform, you know, they performed to the best of the abilities with what they had. And I still think they're doing that. But the only way to keep getting more fire department people and police department people, we have to expand our city and get more businesses here. And unfortunately, Bellevue really is just a, hate to say it, but it's dying. It's losing to other communities around us. It's just a fact. I mean, the pools that my dad and you guys swam at 30 years ago, they're the same condition they were 30 years ago. Nothing's been done. We got one place to go at in this city to do anything fun at, and that's DJ's Dugout. Other than that, there's really no entertainment for youth to bring in new people. There's no entertainment district. I mean, we got the convention center coming up. Pros and cons of that. I think the other most exciting thing we have is Leopard Lanes. I mean, unfortunately, we don't have anything new coming in here. And I know we're going to get some new construction on the Cornhusker where the old Wilson Concrete was, but it's just going to be more strip malls of this, maybe another cellery or retailer there or another sub shop. And that's just not going to create the economic development we need in the city to have more firefighters and fire police people. So as much as I want to have more of them, I think we have to face the sheer reality is we just can't pay for them right now. And we have to find a way to cut some fat in the budget because there's always fat in the budget. And I think to say that there's no way to cut taxes or that this is, 100% efficient, I just disagree with that. I think there could be something that could be cut that we could maybe look to spur on economic development. I know the economic fund is going to be doing that. I wish it was in its own fund. Unfortunately, I think the city of Bellevue has abused some of the funds, and they say the money's there, but I think they, like any government organization, they take from one fund to cover up another fund. I don't have any proof of that, but it's just my way of thinking. I thank you for your time. Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak? I will close public request to be heard. Councilmember Blood?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion by Councilmember Blood, second by Councilmember Priester. Any discussion? Please vote. Vote yes.
All voted yes.